today, we will move right on into chapter 4, and we talk about normal distribution. So the normal distribution is a theoretical probability distribution. Okay. And we just but it's very useful. A lot of things in nature follow the normal distribution. Okay. And so last week we learned a theoretic probability distribution called the binomial distribution. That was a discrete probability distribution, and it gave us answers to questions like if we flipped a coin 20 times, what's the probability that we get 11 heads and 9 tails? Okay. That was the binomial distribution that allowed us to answer questions like that. The normal distribution is continuous, okay? So it cannot answer the probability of getting an exact number, okay? So, I guess, okay, so on a continuous distribution, just, this is not normal, okay? Just, this is an aside. Imagine we've got a spin, right? Kind of like, what's that game? Twister, right? You spin the thing and it points somewhere, okay? If, let's say at the top, we have, it goes from zero all the way around. Right here would be 0.5, and all the way back here would be 1.0, okay? If, because it's continuous, all right? Anywhere we land, we can get, just imagine we can get some extremely precise decimals, okay? Like we can get decimals out to the, you know, 100,000th place, okay? So then I could ask you, what's the probability that the spinner will land exactly at, let's say, 0.40000000. What's the probability that when I flip the spinner, what's the probability that it's going to land exactly at this spot? The answer to that is zero or something infinitely small, okay? Because it's continuous. We can't get, there's the probability that landing at an exact location is zero. However, I can ask, what's the probability that the spinner will land between 0.400000 and 0.50000? And what would your answer be there? There would be a 10% chance. Okay, there's a, because this covers 1/10 of the the circumference, there would be a 10% chance of landing here. Okay. Oh, sorry about this. Is that okay? Okay, so similarly, for the normal distribution, we've got a continuous distribution, and it looks like this. And we will never ask, what's the probability that we get an exact value? Okay? We could do that for the binomial distribution. We could say, what's the probability that we get exactly 11 heads out of 20 coin flips? But for the normal distribution, we will never ask, what's the probability of getting exactly 1.247? Okay? Instead, we always create little ranges. So we might say, what's the probability of getting some number, okay, some number y or higher? We might ask that. Or what's the probability of getting some number y or lower? Or what's the probability of getting some number in between, you know, two values? So let's, so the, what we call the standard normal distribution looks like this. In the center we put in 0. Okay, at the center is 0. So the mean mu is equal to 0. We use the Greek letter mu because we are talking about theoretic distributions, probability distributions, and theoretic distributions, or ones of populations use mu. Okay, so Greek letters for populations. Whereas when we talked about a sample, we would use y bar or x bar, Latin letters for samples. And the standard deviation sigma is equal to 1, okay? And so our distribution probably is right around there. Negative 1, negative 2, negative 3. And technically the distribution goes off to positive and negative infinity. If the entire value, the entire area under the curve is equal to 1, okay? So the entire area under the curve is 1. So if I were to draw a line right here at 0 and shade everything to the left, how much would be shaded?
0.5.
Yeah, 0.5, 50%. Exactly. Okay. So I would say the probability, so let me just actually write some notation here, okay? So if we say the random variable y comes from a normal distribution with mean mu equal to 0 and standard deviation equal to 1. Okay, that's what this picture represents. And I would write this, or shorthand, we would write y comes from normal 0, 1. Okay, and this is just saying normal distribution with mean 0 and standard deviation. This is, this notation represents this picture right here. And our first thing that we've said was that if we were to shade everything less than or equal to 0, the amount that I would shade is equal to 0.5. All right? And so to write that symbolically, we would write the probability that y is less than or equal to 0 is equal to 0.5 in words is that if we draw a line at 0 and shade everything to the left, the area shaded if we shade everything, the area is equal to 1. If we shade everything to the left of 0, we would have 0.5. Yes, question?
Since earlier you mentioned that this is continuous, so there's actually no area under a curve for the value 0. Does it matter if it's less than equal to or just less than?
Yeah, that's a good question. And so if I were to change this, and I said, what's the probability that y is less than or not less than or equal to, but less than 0? The answer to that is also 0.5. Okay, and I know it's a little bit, it feels a little weird, but if you ever took calculus, okay, you would, this might be easier to understand, maybe. Okay, it's like, you know, it's just an integral from negative infinity. So whether I write less than or equal to or less than, when it's continuous, it doesn't matter. Okay, if it's discrete, it does make a difference. But if it's continuous, it doesn't matter. All right, is this okay? What if I didn't draw the line at 0, but what if I went just a tiny bit over to, let's say, 0.01? So 1/100th of a spot to the right, and I shaded everything to the left. How much would you guess would be shaded?
0.5.
Just a smidgen over 0.5. Maybe like 0.51 or something. Okay? And this is where we can use our normal distribution table here. Okay? So if you actually flip over. So there's two sides. Table 3 actually has two pages to it. So if you flip over to the second page, you'll notice in the top left-hand corner, we have z. We've got z, and then it starts off with 0.0 and then 0.00. Okay. So what this is saying is that if I draw a line at 0.00, the probability that y, or in this case it uses the letter z, is less than that is equal to 0.5000. Okay, that's the very first number on that page. And then it says, well, if you go just the very next number is represents 0.01, okay? So it's the intersection between the row 0.0 and the column 0.01. You guys see that? And the number there is 0.5040. Are we okay using this table? Okay. So, and so anywhere I draw a line, okay, I could figure out how much would be shaded to the left. So if I draw a vertical line at 1 and shade everything to the left, so a vertical line at 1.00, how much would I have shaded to the left? 0.8413. Okay? And then we can also get, numbers in between. So what if I went to 1.25? Okay. So for there, I would have to go to the row 1.2 and the column 0.05.
8743.
I think you're looking at the wrong row.
0.8944.
Great. Oh. Is anyone having trouble using this table? Okay. So the table always gives us the area to the left. So if it's like we draw a vertical line at some number, and we're getting the area to the left. Okay. So what if I want the area to the right? What should I do? Yeah, I would just take whatever number I have over here, and I would subtract that from 1. Okay. So if I want, how much do I have for z greater than 1.00? Okay. So now I'm drawing a vertical line at 1, but I'm shading to the right. The answer to that would be equal to 1 minus 0.8413, and I would get 0.1587. Is that okay? Okay. One neat thing is that the normal distribution is symmetric, okay? So I can always get the area to the right by looking up the negative, right? So the area to the right of positive 1, because it's symmetric, is equivalent to the area to the left of negative 1. Can we see that? So to get the answer to this question, if I draw a vertical line at 1 and I want the area to the right, I could do 1 minus 0.8413, or I could just look up negative 1 in the table, which is on the front side, and I would see 0.1587. Okay? So the area to the left negative 1 is equal to the area to the right of positive 1. Or the area to the left of any value z is equal to the area to the right of negative z. Value you want to look up, you can take advantage of that symmetric property of the normal distribution. Okay. Is that okay? All right. Well, then let me. Yes.
I'm sorry. Am I confused? Or there should be area to the left of negative z equals the right of positive z?
It's actually the same thing.
Okay.
Because whether z represents a negative number or a positive number, if you just say, let's in our heads imagine that z is negative 1, then this sentence is exactly the same, right? Area to the left of negative 1 is the area to the right of negative negative 1 or positive 1, okay? And whatever number you use, whether it's negative 1 or positive 3 or positive 0.5 or negative anything, it doesn't matter.
Okay, thanks.
And so you could put a negative here and put the positive there. It's the same. It's all the same. Yeah. Okay. So let's. So tell me how much is in between negative 1 and positive 1. Okay, so there's several ways we can do this, right? So we looked up earlier and we said, well, the area to the left of negative 1 is 0.1587. And that means the area to the right of positive 1 is 0.1587. So the area that's left between negative 1 and 1 has to be 1 minus those two things, right? So we do 0.1587 plus 0.1587. Okay, and we get 1 minus, I can't do this, 0.3274. I think, I don't know. Okay, so now I get 0.6. Six, eight, two, six. Okay. All right. So that's one way. Another way we could do this is I could say, well, the thing that I'm interested in is this portion, right? So using the table, I could find the area to the left of positive 1, which would give me this, and then I could subtract off minus the area to the left of negative 1, which would just be this piece right here. Okay? And so that, if I do that, that will leave me with the piece that I want. So the area to the left of positive 1 is 0.8413. And I could subtract off minus 0.1587. And if I do that, I will also get 0.6826. That okay? Right. So if you're ever looking for an area between two spots, okay, so if we've defined a range, no matter how wide or how small that range is, if we want to know what's the area between A and B, wherever they may be, just do what's, you know, find the probability of being less than B and subtract off the probability of being less than A. Okay, and that works, you know, for all A points A less than B. Okay, so the standard normal distribution is what you have in that table. Okay, the standard normal, also known as the Z distribution, is what you have in your table, and that has a mean of 0 and standard deviation equal to 1. The normal distribution exists just in many different situations. Okay, not everything is normal. Not everything follows the normal distribution, but a lot of things can be approximated by the normal distribution. And these proportions hold. Okay, and it's just every normal distribution actually has the same shape. It's just we've shifted them around, or we've changed the spread, okay? So just imagine this shape here, okay, on a piece of rubber, and we can either, we can shift it up and down the number line, and we can also stretch it to make it wider or thinner, okay? And with that, we can approximate any other distribution that follows the normal distribution. So, for example, in the United States, the height of women is approximately normal, follows a normal distribution. Okay, so so for U.S. Adult women, approximately normal. Guesses for what the mean height of women in the U.S. is?
5'4".
Yeah. It's about 5'4", 5'4 and a half, something around there. Okay? So, what's that? So, in inches, that would be 64 and a half inches. Okay? And the standard deviation, we'll say it's
3.
Okay? It's a little bit different. It's probably like 2.9, okay, or 2.8. But 3 is close enough for our purposes. Okay. So, it follows a normal distribution. I could ask you, what percentage of women, well, here's an easy question. What percentage, if this is the mean, what percentage of women are shorter than 64.5 inches? So what percentage of women are shorter than 64.5 inches? Half or 50%. Okay. So that's easy enough. I could ask what percent of women are shorter than 5'7". So that's 67 inches.
On this one here, you said shorter than, correct?
Oh, are shorter. Yeah. Holding out important words. Okay, what percentage of women are shorter than 67 inches? So here, according to our normal distribution, the mean goes right in the middle at 64.5, and my standard deviation is equal to 3. Okay? And what I want to know is I want to go out to 67 inches, and I want to know what percentage of women are shorter than 67. Well, we can slide this over and stretch or shrink it so it looks like the standard normal. Okay, the standard normal is centered at 0 and has a standard deviation of 3. Okay. So what I want to do is I want to slide this over so this is centered at 0, and I want to change it so that the standard deviation is 1. Okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to subtract 64.5 from every number, and then whatever's left over, I'm going to divide by 3, so it contracts. Okay, and this is called calculating a z-score. Okay. So a z-score, or standardizing. Z-score is the number of standard deviations we are from the mean. So how many standard deviations is 67 from the mean? That's what we're essentially asking. Well, 67 is 2.5 inches above the mean. But how many standard deviations is that? Well, I'm going to take that distance and divide by 3. And I see that 67 is not quite one standard deviation. But 0.83 something, okay. 0.833, okay. So with that, we can now go to the normal table, and what this means is that the probability that any variable y, or the height of a woman's height, female height, is less than 67, because we've standardized this is equal to the probability that z is less than or equal to 0.833. Okay. So with that, I can go to the z table. And the z table only gives me 2 decimals of precision, so I have to round this off, okay? So it's just going to be probability that z is less than 0.83, and the answer to that is what? 0.7967. Okay. The true answer is that it's somewhere between 0.7967 and 0.7995, right? Because 0.83 is 0.7967, and 0.84 is 0.7995. So the real answer is that it's somewhere in between there and there, but we'll just round off to 2 decimals and pick the one that's closest and say that z is less than 0.7967. Is that okay? So about 80% of women are shorter than 67 inches. About 80% shorter than 5'7". 1 in 5 taller, 5'7", approximately. Is that okay? All right, so just why don't we try this as an exercise, okay? So again, we will say, is totally stuck, you can raise your hand. I'll be walking about. Okay, so the first one says, what percentage of women are taller than 63 inches? So I'm going to put the mean at 64.5 as just defined in our problem. And then it says, what percentage are taller than 63? So 63 goes over here, and I want the area to the right. Okay, so I got to figure out my z-score. So how many standard deviations are we away from the mean? So 63 is 1.5 inches below the mean, and each standard deviation is 3 inches. So I'm going to get, we are 1/2 of a standard deviation below the mean. Okay. I look up z equals to negative 0.50 in the table, and this is equal to 0.3095. No, 3085, sorry. 0.3085. That's the area over here. Okay, so the area to the left, the table always gives you the area to the left. We want the area to the right, so I'm going to do 1 minus 0.3085, and that's going to give me 0.6915. Okay? Alternatively, I could have used the symmetry shortcut, and I could have just looked up what's the probability that z is less than positive 0.5. And then the other question says, well, what's the area, what's the probability, or what percentage of women are between 63 and 68 inches, okay? So in that case, I want to find the area in between 68 and 63, okay? Well, 63 inches, we already figured out the z-score, and that's negative 0.5, and we found the probability that z is less than negative 0.5 to be equal to 0.3085. Okay, so we know that this area over here is 0.3085. And what we want to know is, well, how much is in between here? So I'm going to find everything to the left of 68, and then I'm going to subtract off 0.3085. So I get z is equal, so I've got to find the z-score for 68. 68 minus 64.5, divide that by 3, and forget what that is equal to, 1.167, right? My table only gives me 2 decimals of precision, so I have to round that off. So I'm going to choose z is less than positive 1.17, and when I look that up, I get 0.8790. Okay? But that's not my answer. 0.8790 is everything to the left of 68. Everything to the left of 68 is 0.8790. I want what's in between. So I'm going to subtract off this wedge right here. So the area between equals 0.8790 minus 0.3085. And that leaves me with 0.5705. So far I've given you heights, and I said, you know, what percent, or what, you know, what's the probability of being below or higher, things like that. This time we can switch things around, okay? I could say, how tall is a woman in the 90th percentile, okay? let's change it to the 95th percentile. Alright, so this means 95% of women are shorter than this height, and 5% of women are taller than this height. Okay? So 95th percentile means 95% of women are shorter than this height. Okay. All right, so what we want to know, this is our picture. I want to know, what is this height right here? What is that? Okay, where if I were to draw a line right there, I'm going to get 95% over here. Okay. What is that height? Well, before we do that for heights, can we just figure out the z-score that's going to give me 95% to the left? So, look in your z-table and see if you can tell me what's the z-score that's going to give me 95% to the left. Yeah, so there's probably two numbers that are actually equidistant here, okay? I'm going to, z is equal to 1.64, or z equals 1.65, okay? When you pick 1.64, you have 0.8995, where is it? Probability that z is less than 1.64, 0.9495, and then over here, probability that z is less than or equal to 1.65 is equal to 0.9505. All right. Most of the time, they will not be equidistant from the point that you're looking for, and in those cases, just choose whichever one is closer. Okay. Just choose which z-score gives you the closer value. In our situation, because they're equidistant, I'm going to just split the difference and say z is equal to 1.645. Is that okay? So we will use, but for this special circumstance situation, we will use z equals 1.645, okay? In 99 out of 100 times, one of those z's would give you a closer value. Like if I said, find the 90th percentile, you'll choose z is equal to 1.28, because that one gives you 0.8997, which is much closer than the other one, which is 0.90 something something. Okay. Okay, so the z-score that gives me 95% is 1.645. What is the z-score again? It's how many standard deviations we are from the mean. Okay. So what is the height that gives me a z-score of 1.645? in that case, if my mean is 64 inches, to get a z-score of 1.645, I need to be 1.645 times 3 inches above the mean. Does that make sense? Or, you know, it's just the height that's 1.645 standard deviations above the mean. I can just solve the z equation. Z is equal to y minus mu over the standard deviation. In this case, my z is known at 1.645. My y is unknown. My mean is 64.5. And my standard deviation is 3. So solving for y, multiply both sides by 3. Almost 69 and a half inches. So about 5'9 and a half, that's about the 95th percentile. About. So how tall is a woman in the 95th percentile? If it follows the normal distribution exactly with these parameters, it'd be 69.435. For all intents and purposes, probably 5'9 and a half. Especially we, our heights change during the day anyway. So I don't know how accurate anyone's height has ever been measured as accurate out to the thousandth of an inch. All right. So let's just try one more as an exercise to you. And see if you can tell me how tall is a woman in the, let's do the 20th percentile. So we want to know what is the height that's going to give me 20% over here. Mean we got 64.5. Okay, so let's see if we can find the z-score that's going to give us 20%. Right? So we go to our z-table, and we don't look up z equals 0.20. Okay? We're looking up the area that's 0.20, and we're looking for the z that gives us 0.20. Okay? And the closest number I could find to 0.20 is 0.2005, and that corresponds to a z-score of negative 0.84. Alright? So it's in the row z is equal to negative 0.8 and the column 0.04. So I just want to make sure are we okay there? Okay? Because this is the most important step in this problem. Okay, so once we get z is equal to negative 0.84, now it's just a matter of solving for the y that will give us z is equal to negative 0.84. So, just say z is equal to y minus mu over sigma. Set z equal to negative 0.84. This is equal to the y that we are solving for minus the mean, 64.5, divided by 3. And 0.84. 3 gives me negative 2.52. All right, 64. So I get 61.98. Okay, or pretty much 62 inches. Okay. Again, I don't know anybody who gets measured to the hundredth of an inch, but I guess if we did, we would say 61.9, but 62 inches, that's close enough, right? So in this case, how tall is a woman in the 20th percentile? 62 or 5'2". 5'2" would put you know, the 20th percentile, so about 1 in 5 women are shorter than 5'2", 4 in 5 women are taller than 5'2", at least in the approximately. All right. This is again, the normal distribution is this nice, perfectly symmetric thing. It's pretty good, but it's very useful, and a lot of things in nature seem to follow the normal distribution, but not perfect. Okay. All right. Is this okay? Far so good. All right. Well, there's a few things. Okay. These are. this is known as the empirical rule. And this is something that will be useful. I think. I like to think this class will be useful for the rest of your life. But I know that a lot of these calculations by hand probably not going to be as useful. But the empirical rule is one of those rules of thumb that come from the normal distribution that I think is one of those, is a useful rule of thumb, okay? So this is, here's our normal distribution. It technically goes off to negative infinity and positive infinity. It's just that once you get a certain distance away from the mean, things become so rare that they're negligible, okay? So if I put the center here at 0, and I go out one standard deviation, okay? And we could look up z equals positive 1 and z equals negative 1, the area in between here, all right? So it's what's the area between z equals 1 and z equals negative 1, okay?
0.68.
Oh, yeah. The area here is about 68%, okay? Or even further, we can just say about 2/3. Okay? 2/3 would be 66.7. So a tiny bit over 2/3 have z-scores between 1 and negative 1, or about 2/3 are within one standard deviation of the mean. Okay, so another way is we can say about 68% of data in a normal distribution is within one standard deviation of the mean. If you look up 2 and negative 2, you're going to get about 95%. A little bit more than 95%, but about 95%. Of data in a normal distribution is within two standard deviations. Okay. And about, if you go out to three standard deviations, z equals positive 3 and negative 3, you get almost everything. Okay, almost everything, but not everything. So it's about 99.7. Okay, so almost everything. You go out 4 standard deviations, 5 standard deviations, you capture even closer to everything. So these are rules of thumb, but you can say about 2/3 within one standard deviation, about 95% are within 2, and then almost everything is within 3. So if you ever come across something with a z-score over 3, or smaller than negative 3, you know that's rather extraordinary, okay? Because almost everything is within 3 standard deviations. So if you ever come across a z-score greater than 3, you know this is something rather remarkable. Okay. When people talk about things that are, quote, usual, usual generally means z-scores between 2 and negative 2, okay? Because about 95% are between 2 and negative 2, okay? So we might start, and again, these are all just rules of thumb, something approximate. So things that have z-scores beyond 2 and negative 2, you might say, are a little unusual. Things that have z-scores beyond 3 or negative 3, you'd say are rather unusual, okay? And everything where z-scores are between 1 and negative 1, that those are all mundane, okay? So that's the empirical rule. It's based off of the normal distribution, but pretty much anything that's unimodal and symmetric will follow the empirical rule pretty closely, okay? Not exactly, but pretty well. Okay? Is that okay? All right, let's take maybe like a 10-minute break.